heart. 25% of them come with a thorny heart. 25% of them come with a roadside heart, and it's only 25% that has come with the heart of a good soil. Isn't that true of the parable of the sower? So when the word is spread out, 25, 25, 25, but there's a 25 that is a good soil. I pray that you'll be one of that 25. And I pray that the words we're about to say will fall on a good soil in your heart in the name of Jesus. Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. Genesis 21, verse number 28. I will read quickly. Then God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it. Four things. Be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, and subdue it. Then you have dominion. So, if you want to look at the maths there, it will say fruitfulness plus multiplication plus filling the earth and subduing it equals dominion. It says, so have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over everything that moves on the earth. Can you help me to preach to the closest person to you and tell them, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it, and then you have dominion in the name of Jesus. The permission of the Holy Spirit, I will go the way of economics today. Praise the Lord. Economics is a very, very important subject in these end times. And I could see a lot of it right from Genesis to Revelation. You see people multiplying investments in strange ways. You see people forecasting the policies that a nation should get involved in within 7 years that will lead and translate to surplus. You see all of that in the Bible. Jacob was an economist. Joseph was an economist. We see people multiplying investments and saving their nations. Now, those principles of economics were actually stolen from the Bible. And by the grace of God, with the topic we have chosen this morning, I will see how I can communicate that. We have demand and supply, we have international trade, we have monopoly, we have needs, wants, scarcity, choice, and all of that. Majority of them are actually stolen from the Bible that you and I carry unknowingly. The GO told us a story sometimes ago. He said there was a time that was when he was really, really young. So they sat in his father's house. They didn't have a ceiling or a roof like this. It was just thatched roof that was, you know, hay. That was their roof. And there wasn't anything like concrete. It was just ordinary floor. So they sat on the muddy floor there. And he was talking to his dad. And then an old man came into that house. An old man, it was an unpainted house. When they want to paint house in those days, according to him, they use cow dung. How many of you understand what I mean? They use cow dung, and they say, we want to paint a house. That's when they use cow dung. So the man came in and said, look after this boy. He didn't know whether he was a prophet or whether he was just speaking by inspiration. He said, look after this boy. Because through him, your name will be heard all over the world. Is that not so true today? Now, I believe that with what I'm about to explain in a few minutes now, through it, your name and my name will be heard all over the world. Now, I say the next Bill Gates will arise from this church in the name of Jesus. I say the next Arnold Carnegie will arise from this church in the name of Jesus. How many of us know Arnold Carnegie? But we said amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We'll come to that as well. Amen. So we identify, be fruitful. Be fruitful. It's a command. Now the word fruitful is often limited by us to, you know, having children. But if you look at the dictionary meaning of the word fruitful, it actually means productive. So having a child or having children might be one of the units under the definition of fruitfulness. But it is wrong of us to assume that the whole of the ramifications of fruitfulness is about bringing forth. If it is about children alone, then it means Abraham did not do a good job for having just one legitimate child. Now, what I'm about to share with you, if I had known them before, maybe my life would have been better. Poverty is absence of self-production. Poverty steps in when we stop producing. For you to be wealthy and well-to-do in life, you must be a producer of something. Now, I understand the place of salary. It pays the bills, it keeps us going. We must start definitely from that. How many of you know that many of the times before the salary comes, it's already been exhausted, right in the hands of the employer that is yet to pay it, because we have planned it. And at the end of the day, there's virtually nothing left in it. So the way to wealth is not through the salary, as we all know. It can only come through the production of something. But it's not too late. If you want to have the next Bill Gates here, we must produce something. Now, the Bill Gates I'm talking about is not the Bill Gates of now. That what he now busies himself doing is kind of foundation, philanthropy, because, you know, I think for almost 13 consecutive years, that man was declared as the wealthiest man in the world, you know, unbreaking like that. So he's amassed about $90 billion through his lifetime. But I'm not talking of that Bill Gates. I'm talking of the Bill Gates of maybe 1990, when the computers we had then was just about Mac. I'm talking about the Bill Gates of the 1970s and the 1980s. When I was writing my project in school, there wasn't anything like the computer that we see now. We didn't even know it was called computer. What they used to tell us is his language of Foxtrot and Cobol. And we go to the place where we're going to print. The engine alone is like the size of this building. That's a computer. And he starts rolling out the papers. He starts rolling out the papers. And it can be as long as from here, if care is not taken, just papers, to that gate there. How many of you remember the bank statements we used to get before all this computerization came? The bank statements that will have breakable lines in between. So it comes and they fold it something like this for you when you go to get your bank statement. It's always green and white and it's big. That's the days of the Bill Gates I'm talking about. That man was struck by one idea. And that idea is called Windows. Windows this, Windows that, Windows this, Windows that. Small idea called Windows. Whereby you can open multiple pages on a software on the same screen of the computer, without actually moving from one computer to another to do that. Created Windows within one particular system. And through that, the man became what he is today. One idea. Again, going back to our general overseer, there was an accountant who said he was tired of saying yes sir, yes sir, yes sir to his employers. And he went to God and said, Father, give me an idea. Brother Adeleke, as you are looking at me, then receive that idea now. Amen. That will make you a multiplier of investment in the name of Jesus. He said he was tired of serving people, that he wanted people to serve him. And he went to God, God, give me an idea. And God asked him to go and be frying what? Groundnuts. We call it granules where most of us came from. But here, I think they call it monkey nuts. They said, but when you fry your own, fry it with honey. There must be a unique selling point in what you sell, USP they call it, that will take you far, that will make a difference, that will create a difference between what others are doing and what you are about to do. There's a world of difference between invention and innovation. Invention is pioneering. Invention is foundational. So we can say the internet highway is an invention. But the innovations that come on it, like YouTube, the innovations that come on it, like Facebook, the innovations that come on it, like WhatsApp, that is what makes the difference between what YouTube and WhatsApp is doing different from what Google is doing. Google will lay the foundation. What you build on it is what makes it. It's just like research. There's nothing researchable anymore in the world. Everything has been researched. But the extra block that you add to the old existing blocks is what makes the difference. That's what they say. You are now contributing to knowledge because you have added something new. Praise the Lord. Just follow me step by step this morning. Now, the man began to produce his own granules, but he added a little bit of honey, creating a unique selling point. You can sell what others have been selling. You can do the same business that they have been doing, but the extra that makes it extraordinary, or the super that makes it supernatural, is that little thing that you need to add to it, and you just work on what others have done, and before you know it, you are flying. You will fly.
Amen.
You will fly.
Amen.
I will fly.
Amen.
Now, the last time we read about that man who was frying his granules with honey, he had three jets. Accountant, three jets. Many of us are accountants here, probably, or accountants in the making, or you have accountants around you. I will ask you a question. How many accountants do you know that has just one jet? I'm not talking of three now. That has just one. How many? Even the little choppers that fly around the world, the little ones that move you from one plane to another, they are millions of dollars. How many operate at that rate? Salary would not bring that. The only thing that will bring that is called idea. God wanted to give us this van, but he buried the idea in what is called iron ore. God wanted to give us this drum, but he buried the idea in what is called wood. Until all of that is unearthed, in the army they call it mark time. Mark time. Mark time. You not mark time in Jesus' name.
Amen.
A marker of time has his feet moving, but he's not living where he is. Hallelujah. I watch a program on TV. They call it Dragon's Den. How many of us have had that program before? It's usually on Sunday evening. I've set my recording permanently on it. You know, you will say record once or record series. I say record series. Anyone who does not listen or watch that program has not had the idea or does not know what is called zeal or hunger or thirst to have business idea. There are lots of them. You don't need to read wide. You don't need to go to any encyclopedia or library. Just follow that program. They call it Dragon's Den. Dragon's Den will have a panel of about 5 or 6 investors. Each of them must have made not less than £200 million in life. That's the rule. There's Peter Jones. There is Tuka Suleiman. There is Deborah Meading. There is Sarah Willingham. There are many of them there. It's just a 30-minute program. Now, the idea is you will come there. They are investors. They have the cash. You will come with a business idea. You pitch it to them, and they are convinced. Then you share the equity. They said maybe you take 20%, and if they take 20%, you keep 80% so that you can still have your controlling shares. Now, the job there is how to convince them, because they have seen everything that there is to be seen in business. They have seen everything that is there to be seen, and they are here. So what are they looking for? They are looking for person. Who are you? Can I invest in you? And they are looking for product. Do you have something? Have you got something? Majority of the people that come there, they don't convince them. Just about 2 or 3 actually make it to the point of investment if they have an investable idea. You don't have an idea, they say, for this reason, sorry, I'm out. You must be on top of your figures. So what comes in, what goes out, how you do this, how you do that, has a costing manufacturer. If you manufacture here, they will tell you, go to China, you manufacture it for less than half of what you are holding here. And then you're able to save the profits yourself. It is a program and it's free. As you have scar, it is free. My wife knows I don't joke with it. Even old ones, I go back to them. Because you must have something that you are selling. Why do we help people to church? Why do we cook and feed people? Now there are so many churches around, but what is your unique selling point? What are you doing that others are not doing? Because that's where the attraction is. That is what will make you different. You want to go and fish in the pool or in the pond. You've got your hook, but what do you put on the hook? What is the bait that is irresistible that will make the fish want to come to eat at your own bait? There's no sin in it. It's called unique selling point. There is the emotional selling point, ESP. You see an advert. The advert is talking about, for example, automobile, a new car. And you see them bringing almost naked women on the advert. And the advert finishes after 2-3 minutes. And you wonder what the relationship is between the car they are selling and the almost naked people that are there. You see those adverts, don't you see them? You can't correlate them. It's called emotional selling point. They know what they're doing. So that as those things work on your emotions, you begin to think about that Mercedes-Benz that they have advertised. You begin to talk about that Jaguar that they have advertised, and you start saving towards it. It's a program everybody should keep a date with. I'm so sorry, it's not about a Bible today, it's about economics. Because sometimes we need to hear this as well. So there should be something that you are selling, and I pray that the Spirit will unveil it to you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The second verse of that scripture says, be fruitful. The first one which we have just looked at says, the first one says, be fruitful, while the second one says, multiply. 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 Multiply means reproduce. After producing that unique thing, or unique idea that God has given to you, you can't take it further. It cannot become wealth to you until you turn it out en masse. It's like printing. The more you print, the lower you pay. Same with business. The more you turn it out en masse, then you keep your cost low. When the cost becomes low, you'll be able to have a very healthy margin. When I'm talking about margin, I mean profit margin. But if the costs are not low, there is no way you can make profit out of what you have invested in. And the only way to drive down the cost is to produce en masse. Produce what? En masse. There should be flood your targeted market with what you said you have produced. You don't need the whole world to be a success. You just need a targeted audience to be a success. Just look at the audience that you want to capture. But whatever audience you decide to capture, let youths, young people, let them be 70% of it. They spend without recourse to their overdraft position in the bank. They spend without knowing what the loan account is, state it is. They spend without looking at their wallet or what is left. Target audience. Anything you get into, let youth be the core. Or let it be something that attracts youth, or something that they need regularly. Something that they will buy on impulse. Something that no matter what their parents say, it will still find them, go around the corner and get it. But be careful, not cigarettes, not drugs, not alcohols and things like that. Amen. So it has to be produced en masse. It has to be produced en masse. Arnold Carnegie, that I mentioned the other time, did not invent steel, but he pioneered the mass production of steel. Born in 1835, Scotland, migrated to US. He sold that business to J.P. Morgan, who sold it to US Steel Corporation. Let's even look at McDonald's. It's where the Big Mac The one that has about 2 or 3 layers of a burger. You look at Big Mac. How much is it? Maybe plus, if it's a meal, plus the cheese, plus the drink and everything, maybe $5.99, $4.99. But because they rule it out en masse, that is the danger. Big Mac produces 1 billion pieces of that Big Mac worldwide every month. Don't let's go to the billion figures. That might be a hard thing for individuals to get. But you can produce 250 for a start of whatever that business is. Because it's in mass production that cost goes down and gives you a wider margin. You won't believe 1 billion of Big Mac every single month. Even if they are selling, they are undercutting themselves and some other business is underwriting their losses, they will still break through. Why? Because it's done en masse. And that's why God, after saying be fruitful, he said multiply it. Be fruitful and then multiply it. You don't multiply it, you don't get a healthy margin. So don't just seek one or few people as your market, no matter how useful or good a product is. Its success lies in mass production. The fourth thing God said there, he said then replenish. Multiply. Sorry, be fruitful, multiply, and then replenish. What does replenish mean there? I said they stole these things from God. Replenish means distribute it. Distribute it. Have a good network of distribution. Go back to Bill Gates. Bill Gates has a presence in everybody's life in this church. Even in this service, Bill Gates has a presence because everybody uses smartphone. Each one of us has a smartphone, even kids have it. So as long as you have a smartphone, or you have a smart tablet, smart iPad, smart laptop, Bill Gates has a presence in your life. It doesn't have to appear physically. Once you can move from one page to another on your internet, that is idea on Windows. Praise the Lord. And I understand that Facebook has now acquired, what did they acquire? They have acquired WhatsApp. So Facebook will be the written side of things and WhatsApp will be the hearing side of things. Amen. Google has completed plans now to acquire YouTube and Yahoo Mail. You see people replenishing. You see people replenishing. Now you may say all of that, they are very high caliber. Pastor, you should be telling us all of that here. That's why I said when I was writing my project, there wasn't anything like the computer that you see now. The computer is so big and you miss one page. As long as you have to start all over again. Now if somebody had picked that then, and had one way or the other, look for funds and started small. Even if they are going to buy it off him, which is a good way to do business. You push your business up to the, let's just say, £500,000 level, and then you sell it. You sell it 3 million. You sell it 4 million to people who see the potentials, and you have done all the patenting and everything they need to do. And you have a lot of money in your hands just for a sale that didn't last 1 week. But the pioneering job, the only person who can give that idea is God. Somebody slept in the Bible and he said, so a set of animals. The same animals he had been living with. Saw them. These ones are lines. These ones are speckled. Okay, join them together. The product becomes unique. Innovation again. The product becomes unique. And then he said, when I crossed this Jordan, I crossed with just my staff in my hand. But when I was coming back, God has blessed me so much, I came back with 2 banks. And Esau was looking at him, he didn't know what to do again. And if you have a dream, You have an idea, you don't know what to do with it. Look for dream interpreters. You might be the cupbearer in the palace, or you might be the other man who was hanged, then the butler. But there is always a Joseph around you who is planted there to interpret your dreams. And when he interprets your dream, then you see a highway before you. And go and check out all the records and reputation of the interpretation of Joseph. They are laser guided, accurate, on the spot. Look for such people, and then you begin to replenish. You wonder why the Redeemed Christian Church of God is attracting people. Because it was produced in 1952 and was multiplied by a vision of 1998 in Lekki. Lekki is in Lagos. Lagos is in western part of Nigeria, and Nigeria obviously is in western part of Africa. So it's been distributed by the 5 and 10 minutes vision that we all have now. You see it produced in 1952, you see it multiplied by that encounter in 1998, and you see it's been replenished all over the world now because of the 5 minutes vision, 10 minutes vision between each parish. Because of our time, the fourth one is that then you subdue. What does subdue mean in economics? Subdue means you have produced, you have multiplied it, you have replenished. Subdue means control the market. Subdue means what? Control the market. Where I come from, I'm of the Yoruba stock, of the many ethnic groups in Nigeria, which I said is in West Africa. There is a snack we used to eat there. Some of us will remember this. The adult ones will remember. They call it, I don't know what they call it in English, so please just pardon me in advance. They call it robo. How many of us still remember robo? Praise the Lord. Amen. Brother, you remember robo? Brother James, probably. I think it's made from, who can help me? You have to edit all of this, Daddy. Made from granules and made round here, and then it's fried. That alone, if you know how to pack it, is it not all of those things they are now importing to us here now and packing it and calling them olu olu and calling them ali ali and calling them ola ola, and we are buying and we are getting them? But what they call kuli kuli. It's actually a Hausa word. Hausa is the northern part of Nigeria, vast land and vast people of Nigeria in from West Africa. That one is very sweet. When you soak your gari, you know what gari is, Daddy? You don't know what gari is. Gari is a cassava meal. You know, they've taken all the fermentations out of it, they've put weight on it for weeks. And then they now fry it. When they fry it, it comes up like grains. And then you can either make it into food or you can drink it and things like that. That is what gari is. Don't they package those garis and bring them here for us to buy? And don't we buy them? Things are raw. God will not give you finished products. He will give you raw materials. And the raw material coupled with the wisdom that he has given you, and if you don't have that, you can ask for in James chapter 1 verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask, and God that gives all men liberally and a greater child, give to him. That is also there to meet with it. It's a combination of the raw materials and the wisdom that he has given you that translates into wealth. Unbelievers discovered that long ago, and it's working for them. It will work for you too.
Amen.
It will work for you too.
Amen.
Subdue, control the market. You don't control the market, people, the big boys will come and will replicate what you are doing, roll it out en masse, and you won't be able to catch up with them again. That's one of the lessons I also learned from that was then. You patent whatever God, the idea God has given you. Patent takes a lot of money and a lot of time. It's about £4,000 and it takes about 5 years to complete. But once you have it, you are rock solid, covered. If you think that is too much, you can patent your design alone. There's room for it. It can be a trademark. There's room for it. If you can write, you copyright it. Even on things that we do on the computer, you see certain materials that you want to copy and paste. You right click, it doesn't respond. You right click, doesn't, because they have what? Copyrighted it. Sorry, right protected it. Others you copy easily, some you want to copy them, it's not responding. Secured it. Because if you don't subdue the market, the big boys will come and they will take it away from you. Practical things now, because of time. One idea from God, your generation cannot finish it. One idea from God, a whole generation cannot finish it, if it is from God. Everything has to be traceable to God. Everything has to be traceable to God. And that is why 1 John, I think chapter 5, verse 4 says, whatever is born of God overcomes the world. If the idea is born of God, you will see it work for you. And when it works for you, it will not be difficult for you to help the church. All of these things you are talking about, I tell people, look, don't drive the sheep too hard. That's what the Bible says. When Jacob was, he said, don't let us drive the sheep too hard so that they don't get weary. But the point is because we are all on salary. That's why it is hard. If you sit in one corner of Billingham there, or you sit in one corner of Middlesbrough, and from there, from your laptop, you are controlling investments, not even all over the world, in your own village alone, and they are transferring the money back here. Everybody wants to serve God. Everybody loves God. Almost the majority of here has been serving God for years now, and we love God. We want to do God's work. We want to support the work. We want to bless the pastor too. We want to bless the pastor's wife. He is in our heart. But salary is standing between. It won't happen. It will be very hard. Because, of course, the people who knew the figure they are going to give you as salary, they already know your status. You need water, you need air. You need water, you need gas, you need electricity. They know how the ages of your children, they know whether you have a car or you don't have a car. Because through DVLA, all these things are networked. And tax and everything. They know. So when they hand you that 2,500 or 3,500, it's a lot of money, but they know that at the end of the day, to save £50 there, you will. Hallelujah. Let's stand to our feet this afternoon. One prayer. Because when the paper comes, especially those of us expecting paper, when the paper comes, is it not this same job you are going to? £180 a week by the time all the tax are taken off? Maybe £50 a day. That's what we are succumbing to. I can say that with all the forces that I can command. It's as sure as saying the sun will rise tomorrow. That's what we're talking about. How many managers do you know of my call in this country? How many? Except the doctors. How many? Very few. I'm brilliant to know. Very few. Very, very few. How many do you know? It's hard for them to trust us with managerial roles, because they know it's demanding. You have to be creative, you have to be innovative, you have to be... There's something they call self-motivation. They don't have to talk to you, you have to see things. And you see, most majority of us schooled outside here, elementary school. Yeah? In the elementary school, they would have taught them a lot of transferable skills. That when you now become a manager here, and they commit a team to your hands, maybe 6, 7, 8 people. The people that you are supervising, those 8 people, they have those transferable skills from the beginning. You are coming on top of them, maybe because of your degree, or because of your education. But the transferable skills that will work out that thing, you'll be learning it from them. And that's why it's hard for them to put us. One of the reasons why. Not all, but one of the reasons why. When we started practice, it was the clerks in the office, the typists, that were teaching us what we learned in the school when it came to practical. Oga will say, take this file, or this caseload, that's yours, for the month. When Oga has gone, you go back to the clerk. This is the fact. He said, Oga did this case 3 years ago. Okay, similar case. Let me go and bring you the file from the archive. Then you go and bring the file from the archive. He will hand it to you. Then you will see the breakdown, how Oga handled it. And then you now start working out your own way. Transferable skills that they have learned when they were younger. We don't have that advantage. But when it comes to business, it's a leveler. Because it has to do with what you have here and a targeted audience. Buy, sell, and make gain. James chapter 2, I think verse 19. Buy, sell, and what? Make gain. All of us know when we make gain. All of us know when we make losses. It's just a question of simple arithmetic. You look at your bank statement, in, out, balance. In, out, balance. So simple. Let's say, Father. This afternoon, empower me. Open my eyes to see what I need to do. In the name of Jesus. Let's open our mouth and begin to pray. Libra camposicas canteli camposicin treba. Liburicas cantali cambra camposicin tibu campo composicaba. Mazekin tibi cambra cumbasini cantalekin bretembo. You are the only one who can do it, God. Open my eyes, open my eyes, open my eyes. Open my eyes, open my eyes, open my eyes. I can do it on the sides. I can do it on the sides. I can still combine it. I have the brain. I have the ability. I have the time. I have the energy. I have the willingness. When you bless me with it, you will not be wasting your time. It's not a waste of your resources, God. It's not you investing in the wrong container. I am ready. I'm willing. I'm open. Open. Just drop it into my heart. As I read around it, as I research around it, as I talk about it to people, to friends, as I talk about it in the place of prayer, open my heart, drop it in my spirit. What will make a whole difference so that I can affect my generation? Blessed be your name forevermore. Jesus, mighty name, we have prayed. Amen.
And the rest of them, and I believe that your life will not be the same again.